Before we can start talking about films, I think it's important to understand in context how film began. Both the United States and France can probably take equal credit for the invention of the movie camera, but very early, a French photographer named Maury had invented a way of taking stop-motion photography with what he called a photographic gun. Many people found his work exciting. In fact, in Russia, Italy, Germany, and England, other inventors spent their time embellishing his ideas. In America, Muybridge, a photographer that was very impressed by Maury and had visited his studio, was asked by Governor Stanford of California to help him with an experiment to discover if a horse lifted all of his hoofs off of the ground at the same time. Muybridge came up with the ingenious idea of setting up 50 cameras in a row. Each one was triggered by the horse's hooves as it passed. If you put those photographs together, they would make a film strip. But Muybridge was not destined to invent the movie camera. That fell to none other than Thomas Edison. Well, he took credit for it, though it was one of his employees, Mr. Dixon, that actually invented the camera. Once he had the camera, he set up his own studio, which was called the Black Mariah. It was a large black box with a hole in the ceiling on a turntable so that it could receive light all day long. It had been named by a couple of his employees because they felt it was cramped, stuffy, and black, just like the paddy wagons that hustled criminals off to prison. The style of the Edison studio was very pragmatic. It rather stuck to circus performers, vaudeville acts, and the like. Edison's studio was soon replaced by the Biograph studio, which had many more ambitions. Here's a little film strip by one of its most famous directors, Edwin S. Porter. Now, Mr. Porter is famous for a film called The Great Train Robbery. The Great Train Robbery was 11 minutes long, quite an epic for its time. And it was about a robbery. Even the robber turned and fired at the audience, making the viewers all cry out in the theaters. It was a huge hit, and it basically helped the American film industry enormously. This little strip has a close-up, as you'll see. And this was one of the innovations that Mr. Porter brought into the small movies he was making at Biograph. I suppose that this is an example of why the film is called The Gay Shoe Clerk, though the expression, of course, must predate our modern usage. Here's another little film from Biograph that basically has to do with butchering dogs. It's somewhat of a forerunner to some musical like Sweeney Todd. These little film strips were made to amuse and entertain because they were shown in what was called the penny arcades. Many people felt these arcades were merely fads and the whole phenomena of film would simply pass away. Many photographers weren't happy with accepting the limitations of something like the Black Mariah, so they took their cameras out into the street. This remarkable little snippet of the Star Theater in Demolition is one of those rare instances where the photographer probably didn't realize that he was showing a preamble of the possibility of what movement and energy could do in the next two decades that come. It's a wonderful little preamble to the possibilities of kinetic and pure cinema. Meanwhile, in France, the Lumière brothers had also invented a camera, but their camera was capable of projecting the images on a wall or a screen. The Lumière brothers were very socially conscious, and they believed that the camera was a marvelous invention that helped them record real life. The scenes that they shot were very different than those that were being done in the Edison studio. Their work is considered to be the very first documentaries. Their remarkable work showed a sensitivity to light and dark, and a love of movement and energy. These little snippets are filled with a sort of nonchalant simplicity, an authenticity that modern films often try to reproduce. The scene you saw earlier of the women leaving a factory, these soldiers crossing a stream, and citizens in the banlieue having some good-natured fun after a snowstorm, these are filled with cinematic qualities that later films will make use of. There is a protagonist to this little scene. It's the man, of course, with the bicycle, who is beating a retreat, leaving his hat on the ground behind him. Parisians were only willing to sit through these little snippets for so long. There was another filmmaker, Georges Méliès, that took film further in its development. He built a studio very much like Edison's, except it was about three times as big. And he had lights, very high windows on all sides. The kind of dramas that he produced in this studio were exceptional. They involved very elaborate sets, beautiful costumes. He brought in actors to act out the small scenarios that he had made up. In fact, one of his films, The Trip to the Moon, which you see here, he even makes fun of Edison over there on the left-hand side with the blacksmiths carrying on as everyone is preparing to go to the moon. His use of fantasy, his use of comedy, his use of science fiction laid the groundwork for all those milieus. He also, of all things, in one of the films, laid the groundwork for the horror film. Let's look at how film developed a bit further through a film called The Visions of Light, which is about cameramen. I think it best shows how early film developed in America.
The more I've learned and the more I've shot films, when I go back and look what was done in the teens and the 20s, Like some years ago, I had the very good fortune to see an original negative print of Birth of a Nation, shot by Billy Bitzer, who was with Griffith on all of his early films. It was an inspiration to realize what was achieved in that cinematography. I mean, we're talking pretty close to the beginning of everything here, and to realize what he accomplished with the equipment that he had and how quickly so many things became much more sophisticated.
The 20s was really a golden age for cinema because the camera was unencumbered by sound and it was unencumbered by all the devices that accompany verbal dialogue storytelling. It really was a visual medium.
The early movies seem to be freer. I mean, you see like scenes like in Way Down East when Lillian Gish is jumping from a piece of ice to another one. It's almost a documentary. She actually is doing it. And there was no tricks and no studio. The camera was very free. Camera could move very fast. Cameras were much smaller. And the fact that they didn't have sound allowed them to shoot very freely. The camera could be anywhere.
And the Germans in the 20s were really the cutting edge. Directors like Pabst and Murnau really took a lot of the formal elements that came out of German expressionist sculpture and painting and graphics and grafted them into film, as a lot of the European filmmakers, directors like Murnau, came to the United States. The production of Sunrise was a real watershed for American filmmaking. And that film was startling in every aspect, in its design aspect, and it's certainly in its use of expressionistic lighting techniques. Character was revealed in Sunrise through a lot of very complicated lighting changes and dramatic lighting sources that were very, very new and fresh in American films.
They had crane shots that went forever and ever and ever, and they had these kind of rigs that would be rigged overhead in the studios. And this was all very inventive business that they do, to have a fluid camera that would just continue on and on and on, like where we have Steadicams and things like that, and Panaglides. They were doing that some time ago. We're talking 1927.
Everything had to be told visually. And I think when sound came in, that was a great catastrophe for movie making. I still believe that if sound would have come in 10 or 15 years later, I think the art of movies and cinematography would have been much, much higher than even if it is today.
We've all seen those sequences from early sound films where it's all too obvious that there's a microphone planted in a flower vase at the center of the table because all the actors are leaning forward speaking into it.
But I really shouldn't blame you. I'm the son of your employer, and that in itself makes me a low, low scoundrel.
If I didn't trust you, I wouldn't be here.
So here we are. Chopped onion?
Mm-hmm.
The camera can't move at all. It can't even pan or tilt because it's in a huge sort of soundproof refrigerator or ice box. And it took a number of years for cinematographers to start thinking about ways to free the camera again.
If a director, as Ruben Mamoulian did, cared enough to fight for his mobile camera and the whole idea that you could do a sound film where you didn't record sound for every shot, or perhaps you would add the sound later. I think you see with Mamoulian, you see it with Lubitsch, you see some early talkies, you see it with Vidor. I mean, these people refused to be bound to the conventional sound. And good work was being done. It was more difficult.